Hello everyone, FunshineX here. Welcome back to my ComputerCraft EDU tutorial series. This is part 4. Last time we covered the visual editor, got into the basics of programming with the visual editor and made a cool lumberjack program. We also tested the tools that you can give to turtles and what their purposes are. Today we're going to cover the visual editor in a lot more detail, going through most of the components and finding out how they work, what they do, and how you add them to the program. So let's get started with that. First things first, I want to cover a few other things in the visual editor that we didn't get time to cover, the different buttons here. All right, so first things I want to cover, if we've got a new program here, I'm just going to create a new program, leave it as untitled, add a few things here. Remember we were hoping for that feature where we could like insert things or move code around? Well, that actually exists already in the keyboard controls. Basically, you want to highlight over a cell, you can see it lights up whatever you're highlighting it over, and you've got four keyboard controls. Delete, backspace, space, and return. So whatever I'm highlighted over, if right now it's move back, if I hit the delete key, that deletes whatever I'm highlighting, okay? So it'll also shift things up if there's nothing on the row, it'll shift everything up. So that's the delete key. You can use it to clear out your program really fast if you want, okay? Backspace works very similar. It's just going to delete the thing to the left of whatever you're highlighted over there. So if I don't want two move backs here, I could delete that one. You know, see, it's just moving it over to the left, getting rid of whatever it was previously before it. If I hit the space key, it just moves everything over to the right from whatever I'm highlighting. It kind of screws with the highlighter a little bit because it's like you need to add something there, but it's fine. And then the last one is the one that I really wanted was the way to insert rows, and that's just the return key. So if I highlight over anything, hit the return key, it's going to move everything down. So now I've got a way to insert new rows if I missed a section of code, and I can do that there. So that's the keyboard controls. There's four of them. Remember, delete, backspace, space, and return. There we go. Okay, the next thing is, I guess I should keep a program here. Let's put a couple things in here. Even go a little bit complicated. And let's do dig up. What this button here called code editor does is when you're writing these programs in the visual editor, it's actually making Lua code for you in the background. You can then go into this code editor, which I'm about to show you, and make further modifications if there's something in the EDU interface that you cannot do, which you can do pretty much everything, but maybe you want to do a little bit more coding and the actual Lua code, or use this as a tutorial to teach yourself how to code. Code editor is great. I'm going to put one caveat on it, is once you click on the code editor and start making changes, you really can't use the visual editor again. They don't go back and forth. So if you make changes in the code editor, it's not reflected in the visual editor. And if you try to go back to the visual editor, it's going to want to delete all of your changes in the code editor. So only use this once you are completely done with the visual editor and want to go over to the code editor, or if you're just looking at it. So here we go. Click code editor, and you can see my forward and turn right are translated to turtle.forward, turtle.right. I've got my if true, then dig up end, and that's all there, turtle.dig up end. So I can now come back in here and say, oh, look at that. It's got a autocomplete as well. That is really cool. It is case sensitive, so that helps you. And there you go. So now I've got turtle dig up, dig up. Now, you'd think it would be able to know, well, I've used turtle dig up. I know what that command is and display it on the visual editor. But you can see how this program has turned brown instead of pink. Oops. That means it's been modified in the code editor and you're no longer able to go to the visual editor. Click that. It's going to say, you can erase all your changes. Okay. And you can see now it's back to just one turtle dig up and it's back to pink. Cool. So that, there you go. You can use this to look at the Lua code after you've written a program or to modify it further if there's something more in depth you want to make changes to the code. Okay. So that covers that. The next icon here is this disk icon. And that will copy whatever the currently highlighted program you have selected to a disk, to a floppy disk. So I'm going to hit copy, and you can see I've got a program here called Untitled. Let me just call it something else. Program 1, and hit that, and now I've got one called Program 1. So it names the disk for you and copies all the code. Now, normally in ComputerCraft, you'd have to have a disk drive, and you'd put the disk in there and read it and copy the code. In EDU, it's a little bit different. All you have to do is give your friend a disk. So, you know, pretend I'm a friend here and I'm like, oh, thank you, friend, for these wonderful programs you have written. I want to have them on my turtle. Just right-click and eat them. I love it. And you're going to notice now that in my turtles now, the ones I own, I now have, you know, it call it program 2 because program 1 already existed. And yeah, so now I've got the programs that I ate are here. That's pretty cool. So easy way to share your programs. And just remember, if you've got one that has been modified in here, it turns brown and that disk will turn brown. Just so it's easy to know that this disk, this code on this disk has been modified in the code editor. You can't use Visual Editor on it. Pretty cool. All right, so that's the disk. I've already showed what these buttons do, the undo, the step through, and the run, but I really want to show you something else where if we say, let's get a new program here and let's do a place, and I want to clear out his inventory because I want to generate an error basically. So come under here and we can run this program, and you see it's got no items to place. It showed us the error, but if we go back into this program, it actually highlights the block of code that had an error. So it makes it really easy to see, you know, here's the part that errored out. It doesn't auto scroll. So if you have an error that's down on a really low line, you won't be able to see it until you scroll down. Okay, cool. So that's that. And I think that covers all of this. This lock button, unlock button, I'm not sure what the locked and unlocked does. I think it has to do with who can edit it. But I do know the demo is used for the EDU portion, the educational portion, where a teacher can write programs and then the students can use it. The demo mode basically locks it down, so you can't add any new programs. You can only run them. You can't modify the code either. So that's what the demo mode is. I'm not sure quite on the unlock and lock. I'm sure Dan200 will comment below. Okay, so next we have starting to go through these things. So let's put it back in unlocked. Let's create a new program. We don't really care about the title. I'm just going to call it Visual Editor. Okay, so let's go through as many of these components as we can. We've already covered most of the movement ones. Just to rehash, we've got move forward, move backward, move left, turn left, turn right, and move up and move down. So those are the basic movement commands. You cannot strafe, you cannot do really a 360 unless you do turn left 4 times, right? And these all can just be added anywhere on the grid. Really doesn't matter where you add them. They'll just be executed in order as shown by this code editor. Okay? So that's that, and I'm just going to leave it untitled because I don't want to keep typing that in. We'll skip over the movement commands. Now we've got place. Place is pretty easy. You've got three options: place in front of you, place above you, or place below you. Now it's going to go into its inventory and use the currently selected slot. Right now that slot is number 7. So if I put a block in there and then do it, it's going to place that block down. Pretty easy, right? And that's going to work for just about every block in Minecraft or even modded blocks. Okay. Now, what I would like to test next is if we put a turtle in here. Is he going to have any problems with the turtle? Placing another turtle down? Nope, he has no problems with it. So turtles can, if you can get them to craft each other, can then place each other and they're off to go. Unlike in normal computer craft, there's no startup program with EDU that you can modify, so I can't say, you know, Mikey, whenever you're placed in the world, automatically run. You have to click on them and click the run. So I think there's ways to kind of hack into the shell of EDU and maybe change the startup program to do that, but this is supposed to be very simple, so they don't want you to do any of that. It requires you to start the program manually. Okay, back to Leo. The other things we can do with place is you can use items. So let's put some bone meal in there and run this program. You can see it bone meals the ground. Let's put a water bucket in there, run the program. It's going to put some water down. If we use an empty bucket on the water, which we've got now, he will suck up water. So you could use that to get lava out of a lava pool, you know, suck it up, and then export it something into item pipes or whatever you've got, whatever kind of modded Minecraft you're dealing with. All right, so that pretty much covers the place program. You will get an error if the current selected slot is empty or if there's no way here for him to place that item, like if there's an RDM block there and try and place a block, that kind of thing. There we go. Okay, so place is done. We've already used dig quite a bit in the Lumbergap program. But you can see we can dig in front of us, above us, or below us. And the dig tool or the dig component requires a tool. We covered that in the last episode, so if you want to know what each tool does, then you'll have to go back and look at that. And based on whether you can even dig it in the first place, and if you do dig it, do you get it in the inventory of the turtle? So we'll skip right over that one pretty quick. All right, so now we've got drop items and take items. Drop items, you can do the same thing, in front of you, below you, or above you. And normally all that's going to do is take the current selected slot, so let's put a cobble in there, and run it. You can see he's just going to throw it out the front. If we change it to drop above, there we go, and run it. Oh, that aired because he's got nothing in there. Let's put the cobble back in there. There he goes. And he's going to throw a whole stack at once. Okay. So that is drop. Now drop's got a few special things. If you put a chest down, so let's get a chest in front of him and turn this back to drop forward. And make sure he has some items. He will put the items in the chest. This works with modded items. Anything that has an inventory, it will go in as if it went through this side of the inventory. And it will go in just a chest or any kind of inventory. That works above him and below him as well. The other thing we might want to check is, can we drop not a whole stack? Because normally it will drop an entire stack. And there's no way to specify here. But if we go over to the code editor and do add something in there, you can see we changed to brown. That's okay. Make sure he has something in his inventory. And we run the program. You can see he spit out just one. So here's a case where ComputerCraft EDU does not give you everything that you can do, and you would need to use the code editor if you wanted to say just drop one of an item. But that's a really simple change. Just go in and change it in the code editor after you're done programming with the visual editor. Okay. Oops. There we go. So that's drop. Take items is the very, very similar. You can take from the before in front of him, below him, or above him. And if you don't have any inventory, he will just suck it off the ground. Oh, I died him again. So you can see, oh, that wasn't quite in front of him. It kind of has to be pretty close to him here. There we go. So he sucked those in. So he can act as a vacuum as long as the items are within one block, either on top of him, below him, or in front of him. So usually when I do this, I use some kind of like a water channel to push items right to him, right in front of him, so it's easy for him to pick them up. Especially if you're doing a lumberjack program, you'd want to have all the saplings drop into water, come into a single slot, and then the turtle could easily pick them up. All right, I don't like him being white, so we better fix him here. There we go. All right, so that's the same thing. It works with a chest, so there's a couple caveats with that. Let's put a chest down. Let's put some items in here. Let's put the redstone out like that. The pork chops. There we go. Let's keep a little bit for there. Okay, so turtle dot take items. Is that what it's called? It's called turtle dot suck. That's what I want to keep saying, but it's called take items here. If we have we've got slot 7 selected, and we're going to be taking the first item out of this inventory, which is dirt. It's going to try and put it 7, fail, 8, fail, and so it should put it in 9. Let's verify that. Yes, it did. And you see it took both dirt, even though they were in separate things. So if we put some redstone here, normally you'd expect it just to take this 10 redstone, the next time take 13, but actually it tries to take a full stack of whatever the first item is. So it should get all of this redstone. You can see there it did, it got all of the redstone. And then it would get the pork chops and then the oak wood. And again, it would work above him, below him. There you go. Okay, so that is turtle.takeItems, or turtle.suck. A couple more that we'll cover in this episode, and then we'll cover the rest in the next one. Attack, we've already seen. You can attack in front of you, above you, or below you. And it uses, the damage of the tool. We found out the sword was the most damaging, so use a sword if you want to use this in a mob farm. It will kill the mob and drop items as if a player had killed it. That's one thing really, a lot of people use turtles as a mob farm for. is because it's as if a player killed a mob. And there's a lot of modded things and vanilla things that say, you know, this only drops if a player killed it. So it will drop experience, it will drop bonus items like carrots from a zombie, that kind of thing. It'll drop armor. So it's just as if a player killed it. Okay, so that's Turtle Attack. Not much to do there. We've now got Set Redstone, and this is going to show our first foray into the kind of the visual editor syntax highlighting. Before, we've just added one single component here. But now the Set Redstone requires a second component added, and this is added a Boolean. And Set Redstone takes a Boolean, true or false. It does not work in analog, so you can't say, like, set a redstone signal with a power of 4. It's either on or it's off. That's the only way it works in computer craft. So we're going to have the redstone here, and now we can click this, and it kind of gives you less options here, things that you might want to use, but really we don't want to use true or false, or we could say not based on expectation. So there's actually quite a few things that we could do here to fill that in, but the easiest way is just, you know, set it to true or set it to false. And we'll see those, they're all down here, so we'll get to them, don't worry. So if we set a redstone, we set true, now this should work. We can get some redstone out of our inventory just to check here and run it. And you can see it turns on the redstone signal. Go back, set it to false, run, and it turns off the redstone signal. Okay, so really cool. You can do it again above him, below him, in front of him. And turn signals on or off. So you can have them open doors, turn things on or off, and interact with modded things like turn engines on, that kind of thing. Okay, the comment section has no bearing on your code. It doesn't do anything. It's actually a Lua comment. So why would we want it? It's a good practice. So especially if you're sharing your code or if you're writing a lot of code, is you might understand what you're doing today or right now, but when you go back and look at it in a week or a month or even a year, in some of cases of some of my videos where people comment on my videos a year later going, I don't get this, and I have to go look at the code going, I don't remember what I wrote. So that's where comments come in. They help you understand what you wrote and what's going on in the code. So say in that lumberjack program, we had him do a loop to move up until the no wood. So you might want to put a comment, say move up until no wood. And we'd okay. And then we'd add our things, you know, move up and dig up and that kind of thing. And now when we look at the code editor, if we ever do, we can see it says move up until no wood. And we can say, okay, that section of code, now I remember what it does or what I was trying to do. Okay. So I would advise putting comments in, maybe put them at the end of the line, you know, so it'll put them afterward and it'll just be really easy to just have comments. You don't have to put them on every line. I mean, if it's just move up, don't put a comment that says move up. That's obvious, you know, or move forward. Yeah, just put them on sections of the code so you understand what they mean. All right, the last one that we'll cover in this episode is a select slot. You notice a lot of these things we've been doing work on whatever slot has been selected. Here's how you change that. So select slot is another one that requires a second component, and this one is a number. And when you click on this, it's... click on number here. It's really cool. It shows you the value. So if I want to select the first slot, I would know that's number 1. You know, and you click on here and I get OK. Or if I want to change it to something else, select the last slot. There we go. And this works with a ton of other things, you know, like random numbers, saving on variables, you know, addition and subtracting to find out a value. So we'll cover those later. But I just want to show you that that's how you do that. So let's say select slot 1. We'll run it, look in our inventory, and see it's now selected slot 1. So that's how you do it. So, guys, I hope you liked this episode. It was pretty basic on the first section of components here in the visual editor. Next time, we'll get into all the green box. Actually, we might skip down and do a bunch of these because they're easier to understand than the green ones. Maybe we'll have time for all of them. I'll just move really fast. If you guys are as fond of computercraft edu as I am, please hit that like button so that other people can see this video. If you want to see more videos, make sure you subscribe to my channel completely free. Follow me on Twitter at FunctionX, where I'll announce every single time I publish a video or what's upcoming. Sometimes I ask questions for my viewers. And don't forget to go check out the Computercraft forums, where you can interact with Dan200 and other authors there. If you have any questions, you know, kind of go back and through forward on a forum base. And hope to see you guys in the next episode. This has been FunctionX. So catch you later. Bye.